Hello, I'm Steve Curry. I've been recording and editing these COVID-19 editions of our worship service for the last couple of months. And this week, a little something different for the openings and the closings. So Stephanie asked me to explain what I was up to. One of the challenges each week is finding photographs to assemble, to put together for the openings and closings. And I'd like to thank all the congregation members who've been sending that in. And also thanks to Tony and Lisa Grimsley who've been sending in the music. This week though, it's graduation Sunday, a time when we honor our graduates, those young people in our congregation who are moving on to the next stage in their life. And that's often a time to look forward, but also a time to look back. Coincidentally, at the same time, Dennis Moon sent me a trove of photographs dating back all the way to 2006. And so I've been looking through those pictures to put together some opens and closes for the worship services. And as it turns out, it's been a chance for me to look back as well and to think about what our future might be. So coincidentally, we are honoring our graduates, looking backward and looking forward. And we are looking at our church's history, the recent history, back and perhaps what's going forward. So this week, I have put together some photographs that look at where Fairview was a few years ago and where we are now. And as I was going through the pictures, I came across a very few pictures of our graduates doing some things at Fairview over the past few years. So coming up is just that, a look at where Fairview was a few years ago and is now, and a few pictures of where some of our graduates were then, and of course during the service, where they are now. I hope you enjoy it. I forgot to say, tune in at the end for pictures of our 2014 Run for Shelter.
There's a land beyond the river that we call the sweet forever, and we only reach that shore by fate's decree. Yes, I want to see my Jesus, shake his hand and have him greet us when they ring those gold.
Welcome to worship at Fairview Presbyterian Church on this seventh Sunday of Easter. I am the Reverend Stephanie Bishop, and I am the interim pastor at this little church in Lawrenceville, Georgia. This morning, we have these beautiful yellow roses on the pulpit to honor a new baby in our midst. Patty Gillespie, one of our members, has welcomed a new grandson into her family. Henry Douglas Gillespie was born on Friday, May 15th, to her son David and his wife, and we are so excited for them. When we get to the time in our service for our tithes and our offerings, I hope that you will also continue to remember the Lawrenceville Co-op in your donations. If you'll just note on your check that part of your donation, part of your tithe or your offering to the church go to the Lawrenceville Co-op. Ray Ruhlbach continues to really take care of those offerings. He goes and he buys the food for the co-op and delivers it so that you don't have to go out and do that yourself. And we're just really committed to helping feed the hungry in this community. This morning, Pat Gutendorf is our guest liturgist. I'm so glad to hear her voice this morning. You will hear notes of the Ascension of the Lord in this liturgy and in the sermon this morning. The day that we recognize that was on Thursday. So I hope that you will join us in turning your hearts and minds to worship now.
Please join me in the call to worship. Shout for joy, sing songs of praise, for God reigns over all the earth. God has gone up with a shout. Sound the trumpets and sing songs of praise.
Jesus tells us that repentance and forgiveness is to be offered in His name. Therefore, let us confess our sins to God, who assures us of new life through the power of Christ's redeeming love. Let us join in one voice. Living God, we confess that our faith is sometimes weak, our love for others can be faint, our prayers are often timid, and our gratitude is frequently unconvincing. When we stand looking toward heaven, yet feel far from you, you draw near in mercy to forgive us and fill us with your power through the grace of Jesus, our resurrected Savior. Amen. Sisters and brothers, as Christ is our witness, God's power to pardon is immeasurable. Therefore, proclaim this good news to the ends of the earth. Through the mercy of Christ, our sins are forgiven. Amen.
Please join me in prayer. O God of glory, sovereign of all nations, the risen and ascended Christ calls us to carry your message of life to all people. Led by the power of your Holy Spirit, may we witness always to the hope to which we are called as we share Christ's love to the ends of the earth. This morning, may you open our minds to see the power of Scripture, to give life, enlighten our hearts that we might see Christ in whom we meet. In the name of the one holy and living God, to whom we give all glory. Amen.
Hey kids, good morning. I hope you had a really good week. This morning I want to talk to you about something that you might know a little something about. I want to talk about timeouts. Hopefully you didn't have to go into too many timeouts this past week, but I remember when my kids were little. My kids were really good kids, but sometimes they had a hard time getting along, or the rules are just hard to follow when you're little. And so sometimes I'd have to put one or the other or even both of them into a timeout. But what I remember more than putting the kids into a timeout are the times when I really wanted to put myself into a timeout. I would get tired or cranky and I would just want to go into my own room and close the door and have some time alone. Well, I just want you to know that that's okay. Jesus does that. In many stories in the Bible, we hear about how Jesus wanted to just take some time to go away and be alone and pray to God. And so I want you to remember that during the week when we're spending all this time together in our homes, that your mom or dad might just need a little time away. And you might need a little time away too. And that's okay. So just take some time and go and close the door and have some quiet time to spend alone with God. And now, I hope that you will stick around because I'm going to go in, I'm going to put my robe back on, and I'm going to honor some of the big kids from Fairview. And I hope you'll stick around and watch us honor them for something very special that they have done. And we'll pray all together at the end. So I'm going to go now. See you next week. We have a very special part of our service this morning that we are sad we cannot all be together for, but we want to recognize those in our midst, our members who are graduating and celebrating very special moments in their life right now. And so I hope that you will join with me in celebrating each of these young people as you hear about their accomplishments. First, we have Drew Fitton, who graduated with a 4.0 from Peachtree Ridge High School. He will be attending Georgia Tech in the fall and majoring in mechanical engineering. Next is Katie Fitton, who graduated summa cum laude as a doctor of pharmacy from the University of Georgia. She will be starting a first-year residency program at the University of Utah Hospital in June. Zach Greenwood graduated with a BBA in economics and a minor in Spanish from the University of Georgia. He will be pursuing a job in his field. Finally, Sarah Grimsley graduated cum laude as a Juris Doctor in Law from Georgia State University. She will be taking the bar exam this fall. Let us pray. Dear God, we thank you for these young people in our midst and this church family that loves them so. We praise you that our youngest ones have so much to learn about you and families and a church home that will cherish teaching them about your love and following you. We are so grateful and humbled to have these young adults in our midst who have grown and thrived in your world already. Be with them as they go out forth from this moment in time and place. Help them shine your light brightly as they seek to live and prosper in your world. Help all the young people of Fairview, from the smallest to the all grown up, remember to take time away to rest in you. We pray all this in your Son's holy name. Amen.
First scripture reading is 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 12 to 14, then chapter 5, 6 to 11. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that is taking place among you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you are sharing Christ's sufferings, so that you may also be glad and shout for joy when his glory is revealed. If you are reviled for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory, which is the Spirit of God, is resting on you. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that he may exalt you in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Discipline yourselves. Keep alert. Like a roaring lion, your adversary, the devil, prowls around, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, steadfast in your faith, for you know that your brothers and sisters in all the world are undergoing the same kinds of suffering. And after you have suffered for a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, support, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen.
Our second scripture reading this morning is from Acts chapter 1, verses 6 through 14. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? He replied, it is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus who has been taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day journey away. When they had entered the city, they went to the room upstairs where they were staying, Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. All these were constantly devoting themselves to prayer, together with certain women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, as well as his brothers. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We spent the last few weeks in Acts hearing from Peter and from Paul. This week we go back into the book of Acts and back in time to the beginning of the narration, which begins with the ascension of Jesus Christ. Here we are in preparation for Pentecost next week, anticipating the coming of the Holy Spirit. The words we read are not spoken words, but are from the author himself, the same as the writer of the Gospel of Luke. The end of Luke and the beginning of Acts overlap momentarily. not in the exact words themselves, but in content. The end of Luke concludes with Jesus exhorting that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem, and promising power from on high to the disciples just before his ascension. So here in Acts, we have Jesus also promising power in this account, naming the power as the Holy Spirit, and pointedly telling his disciples that they are to be witnesses for him going forth. And with that, he departs. He is lifted up in a cloud, disappearing from their sight. I imagine they were transfixed, immobilized by what they saw, but not for long, because these two angelic figures appear to spur them to move. "Why are you just standing there looking up to heaven?" they ask. This seems not unlike when parents tell their kids to go do something and they just stare back at blankly. "What are you looking at? Go on." As if to be sure the disciples don't argue that they are waiting to see what happens to Jesus, these men in white preemptively tell them that Jesus will one day come in the same way he left. And so this little scene is broken up and the disciples return to Jerusalem. But they have been handed no small task. They understand they have a calling, a purpose. They gather in community with other faithful believers and they pray constantly and together, the text tells us. They are praying and being patient because, and let's be clear, even if they have come to realize that the return of Jesus Christ is not imminent, they are still waiting on the promised power of the Holy Spirit at this moment in our story. But they are not passively waiting. This moment reminds me a lot of Advent, where we await the coming of the Christ child with active waiting. This is the same kind of moment in time. They are hopefully, expectantly waiting. As one theologian says, the ascension does not mean the cessation of Jesus' ministry. It does not mean Jesus' absence. It does not mean the suspension of God's activity to reclaim the world. Quite the opposite. And it seems the faithful followers in that moment got that. They asked the question, "Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel?" And they had gotten an answer, not the one they hoped for, I imagine. No one likes to be told they can't have answers to their questions. In a recent conversation with my grandmother, we asked her why she wanted to know something. I don't even remember what it was, but her response was so memorable. "I am 96 years old," she said. "I need to know everything." It is hard not to have answers, to know everything, but these early Christians still waited with hopeful anticipation of what was next for them. I have come to realize that I tend to view my life probably more metaphorically than most people. I like to use metaphors in my writing, and you might notice that in your monthly newsletters. Comparing things helps me process what is happening around me, work through my thoughts and feelings, and sometimes view things with more humor and hope than I might otherwise. However, I do try to refrain from using too many metaphors in my preaching to you all. I run the risk of having you think I mean something that I don't. Like today, I want to talk to you about waiting. We are doing some really hard waiting right now. I pray we are doing some really hopeful waiting right now. But what I don't want you to think is that I'm comparing this waiting on this pandemic to end to what waiting on the arrival of the Holy Spirit was like for the disciples and other believers after the ascension, or waiting on the return of Christ, or even like Advent waiting, waiting on the birth of the Christ child. Our waiting is different now, but we should be doing just as the followers were doing those days before Pentecost, praying fervently and gathering virtually as we can with others. I think the verses from the first letter of Peter that Pat read for us are helpful here. "Cast all your anxiety on God. Be alert to temptations and resist them. Be in solidarity with humanity as we are all enduring this together, and trust that God will restore us." I've paraphrased the verses of chapter 5 that we read because they seem transferable to our current plight. But what we must realize is that while we are now enduring and suffering at the hands of this coronavirus, some waiting, some suffering and enduring may have the opportunity to come to an end. For one, vulnerable populations are being recognized as just that, and extra care is being taken to keep them safe. We are finally beginning to take note of the disparities and inequities in our culture, that our Black and Brown brothers and sisters are suffering more through this pandemic than our white population. And even our earth, God's good creation is letting us know that it was waiting for us to straighten up our act here. The air is so much cleaner. The canals of Venice are full of water, so clear now you can see the marine life returning there, and even global emissions have fallen. These are all undeniably good things that are happening in our world in reaction to a very, very bad pandemic. Would any of us have wished for this pandemic to make these changes come about? Certainly not. The effects on human lives have been great, from economic instability, the toll on our mental and physical health, the loss of so many lives. No one would have wished this. But that is why it is so important to not let the good that has come out of it slip away. While we wait for our return to normal, can we plot a new normal that remembers the better ways we behaved during this tragic event? Can we continue to take care of our weakest members of society? Can we work to end the inequality in our races and cultures? Can we continue to find ways to improve our climate and not just go back to life as we once knew it before this happened? In the book of Acts, the early Christians wait. Yes, they wait and they pray and they devote themselves to their faith. But they are also gearing up, getting ready for what is to come. Once the Holy Spirit comes upon them, they are off and running and working to spread the news of Jesus Christ and the church. Matt Skinner, a theologian and a preacher, says this about the early Christians in the time between the Ascension and Pentecost. The waiting period conditions them to be attentive to God so that they might respond when the time is right. They wait in a context of enormous and not fully explained expectations. They live in uneasy anticipation of the new realities that Jesus has initiated. Living like this requires just as much courage as if Jesus had told them to go out immediately and change the world using their own brains and muscles. They wait, not because they see it as their only option, but because they expect big things to come from God, things in which they will be privileged to play important roles. So, are we gearing up? Are we waiting, praying, devoting our time and energy into thinking about what this world could be like? Are we ready, when the time is right, to make amends for the ways we have overlooked the powerless, the indigent, the hungry, the homeless? Are we prepared to treat our earth in a kinder way, taking care now to notice how quickly she reacts to our doing right by her, and moving into the future with new plans for how to ensure we take care of our resources and use them the best and most responsible ways we can? I pray that we are. The disciples ask Jesus if he is restoring the kingdom to Israel, and he tells them to go spread the word to all the ends of the earth. Friends, we are all in this together. Bound in our common humanity, we must work to make this world better for all God's creation. So wait. While our waiting is different than the waiting for the Holy Spirit that the disciples did, it can still be good and productive. And really, our waiting is never really done. When this pandemic is over, we will have more periods of waiting, whether they are personal or global. But wait with renewed energy for what might be. Wait with constant prayers, the way the disciples modeled for us. And wait with hope that we might find ourselves living in the world that God longs for us to experience as one good and beautiful creation. Altogether, amen. Let us pray. This day and always, let us not cease to give thanks to God who has seated the resurrected and ascended Christ at the right hand of the Holy One in power and great glory. We give thanks to you, O God, in this and every age for the healing power at work in Christ to fill our world with grace. We pray for our world, for all leaders, people, and nations, that they may exercise a spirit of wisdom and that all might work to serve the common good. We ask that you be with researchers and doctors, nurses, clinicians, and volunteers as they speedily navigate finding a vaccine that will bring relief from the pandemic. Be with those in the public health sector as they work to contain the spread of the virus and keep our most vulnerable safe from its harm. Infiltrate the hearts of your people that we might, out of great empathy for all humanity, do what is best for all people. O God, we know that even though our news is permeated with information about the virus, other places are still afflicted from the terrors of violence and war. Shield all who suffer and bring them to safety and new life in you. Make us one family, gathered up in your love and clothed in your power of your peace. We pray for all who long to experience the immeasurable power of your love. Open our hearts to sing your praises and to share the story of your blessing, that all may come to know our living and ascended Christ. Bless your people everywhere with food, shelter, health care, and employment sufficient for our flourishing, that all may thrive together by the riches of your grace, and fill us with a joy for justice that inspires us to do our part for the prosperity of all. We pray for all in sickness or in need, for all who are lonely and hopeless, that they may know your healing love and the power of Christ to bring life in the most difficult times. Keep us mindful of the hope and great power that we have in you as we offer your healing to others. All this we pray in the name of him who raised to live and reign in power for us, and who taught us how to pray to you, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. God has given us the gift of Christ, risen and ascended for the life of the world. Therefore, let us offer our gifts in return, that others may know this glorious news. Let us pray. O God of all glory and majesty, we give you thanks for the gift of your Son and his power at work in our lives and our gifts. Bless these gifts for the benefits that they afford in bringing life to others in your name. Bless our lives that we may be your witnesses to the end of the earth as we love and serve you, O God Most High. Amen. Friends, as you go about this day, this week, this month, this year, and as you wait, actively wait, pray and hope. Pray and hope for what can be better in this world and how you can be part of making this world, this God's creation, a better place for all. And now go in peace, knowing that the Lord our God has plans to prosper you and not harm you, plans for your hope and your future. Amen.
At the burning bush, the burning bush, the burning bush. God spoke to Moses at the burning bush, saying, I'm the Lord thy God. Take your shoes off, Moses, you're on holy ground, on holy ground. Take your shoes off, Moses, you're on holy ground, for I'm the Lord thy God. Go yonder, Moses, and smite that rock, smite that rock, smite that rock. Go yonder, Moses, and smite that. Salvation.